Good morning, everyone. I hope everyone has enjoyed the programming thus far. My name is Darian Aguili. I'm a first year MBA student here at Fuqua, and I have the honor and privilege of introducing our next panel, discussing next generation energy ventures within the ever-evolving industry. So our discussion leader is Jamie Jones, assistant professor of the practice and director of Duke INE here on campus. Annie Baldwin is a senior manager of product management at Form Energy, a battery technology company focused on enhancing the grid and making it fully renewable. Chris Fendley is the director of commercial development of TerraPower, an American nuclear design and development company. And last but not least, Akash Patel is the CFO of Net Power, a company succinctly focused on slashing carbon emissions. So without further ado, let's give the panelists up here a round of applause and get started.
Excellent. We are excited to be here with you today and excited to engage. And so as you're listening to this panel, make sure you're preparing your questions because you're going to have ample opportunity at the end of the session to start to ask those. But to frame this up, panelists, I would like to hear from each of you. Tell me more about your venture. What are you working on? What gap or need is it filling in the energy space? Tell us more about you and what you're working on. And why don't you kick us off, Chris?
Sure. So TerraPower was founded about 14 years ago by Bill Gates. Really focused on what is the energy solution, very much a futurist in looking forward, and even then recognized the need for more power in energy and also carbon free. And so we work on new nuclear technologies, reactor technologies. We're what we call a nuclear innovation company. We also have a medical part of it, but I'll focus on the reactors here today. But we've designed a reactor called the Natrium reactor. That reactor both produces carbon-free power, but also has an energy storage component to it. So we've combined nuclear with solar salt. So the concentrating solar industry today uses salt to store energy and then provide that when the sun's not available. We're using the same type of technology to also make nuclear really flexible, because we think the grid of the future definitely does not look like the grid of the past, right? And where nuclear was a base load source and everything else made the accommodation for it, this, we really flipped it on its head. Renewables are going to be that, if renewables are available, they're cheap and you should put them on the grid, right? But when they're not, we'll have nuclear available, so we still have carbon-free power. And we have a demonstration project in Wyoming, scheduled to be completed in 2028, our first reactor. I'll go into a little more later.
That's terrific. Thanks, Chris. Annie, what about you?
Yeah, so I work at Form Energy. We are a battery manufacturing company. Like you guys, we were really founded with the focus on the problem first. So how do you make the grid fully renewable, reliable, and cost-effective? And we did a broad survey of what are the characteristics of a battery storage technology that you want to solve that problem. And what we found is that today you might have lithium-ion storage. It lasts for a couple hours, which works well today. But in the future, what we've seen is that the grid looks really different. You often have these multi-day weather events, cold snaps, heat waves, et cetera. So you need a new kind of storage technology that lasts for many hours. And also does that at very low cost. So we're commercializing an iron air battery that lasts for 100 hours and can do that at 1/10 the installed cost of lithium ion. The basic principle of operation is reversible rusting. So when you want to discharge electricity, you breathe in air and then you convert iron to rust. And then on charging, you reversed out that process. So we were founded about 2017. Since then, we've grown a bunch. We're over 350 employees across the US. We have R&D based in Somerville, Massachusetts. I work out of our Berkeley office. That's where we do product development and scaling. And then we also have a manufacturing facility in Pennsylvania. So I've been growing a ton. Also really focused on how do you build the grid of the future. We'll be commercializing our first technology with Great River Energy. They are a co-op in northern Minnesota in 2024.
Great. Thank you so much. Akash.
Yeah, I mean, no different. I think all of us are just trying to solve the energy trilemma, right? Clean, reliable, and affordable. Net Power is no different in that regard. Company was founded in 2010, so 12 years old. Over that time period, we've validated our technology through a demonstration plant in Texas, and now we're on the pathway to commercialization. So what do we do? We have a semi-closed loop supercritical CO2 cycle that allows you to effectively burn natural gas, generate electricity, and capture all the emissions. And that provides a number of things. It provides clean, reliable, and affordable energy, but also it utilizes a vastly available fuel base with existing infrastructure here in the US in particular. So when we think about energy security, it's an important thing that we're trying to also solve for.
Excellent. And so as you think about, you know, startup world, you oftentimes have both technology risk and market risk. And the whole goal of a startup early on is to start to de-risk both sides of that. And I'd love to hear in this complex space that you're working in, how each of your startups really focused on de-risking the technology and de-risking the market opportunity. So what was the early validation steps you took along each of those fronts? Annie, why don't you start us off?
Yeah, this is actually one of my favorite things about Form is that we really started with the problem first and spending a lot of time on how you want to solve that well and then bringing our technology to meet that problem. So we kind of validated the market opportunity in two ways. One is direct customer engagement. Most of our executive team are very experienced folks from the energy storage business. And they just, even Matteo, our CEO, spent a lot of time talking with utilities and really understanding What do you really need to replace gas plants in the future? What does that technology look like? So there was a lot of like early investor conversations, a lot of utility engagement. And then the other piece is actually really detailed modeling. So really early when Form got started, we basically figured out how to replicate how utilities plan and invest in grids of the future. So we built a new analytics solution called Formware, which basically replicates how utilities do that planning and investment cycles and replicates what happens when you have lots of renewables on the electricity grid. So through that detailed modeling, we were able to inform what the basically product design space of our storage solution looked like. So what are the trade-offs that you want to make on key performance characteristics like cost, round-trip efficiency, cycling behavior? And we used that to inform what the iron air technology really needed to perform at in order to deliver deliver real value for utilities. So that's more on the market side. And then on the technology validation side, we spent basically 2 years selecting what the right technology solution was to meet that market need. So we did a broad survey of electrochemical technologies. There's actually a paper written by one of our co-founders who looked at basically the installed chemical cost of existing electrochemical couples and found that iron air is really, really cheap. And then we also selected iron air based on a number of other kind of established industry knowledge. So basically, not just on cost, but also on reliability, cyclability, the safety is a really big thing as well. You know, we're an iron air chemistry. So we basically spent a long time selecting that right chemistry. And then in the last couple of years, we've done a lot on investing in product design, development, really validating that at kind of the subscale modules phase. And now we're basically focused on manufacturing and ramp up. So a broad process of bringing together both the market and technology. And over the last 5 years, we've done that and now ready to scale.
Fantastic. And Akash, you mentioned a pilot plant. Was there work that you did prior to that to understand both technology and market and have confidence before you make that large scale investment?
Yeah. So, you know, we went about technical and commercial validation simultaneously, and it kind of weaved in the financing of the company and raising the capital we needed. So the first outside round the company did was in 2012, and that was with an EPC company, engineering, procurement, and construction company. And the goal there was to get funding, but also for the EPC to do the paper, math, science, engineering to confirm that you could build a facility at a large scale that can be done economically and you could produce electricity for cheap enough. And so that was the first step in commercial validation to a certain extent. The next step was, okay, well, we should build a demonstration site to technically validate it. And so we went out and got another investor to come in. At the time, it was Exelon, which was, you know, largest nuke operator in the country, came in. They put in a large investment, and we used that money to build our demonstration site. So now, not only did we have money to build the demonstration site to technically validate that you can do the process and it can generate electricity, but also you had someone that was effectively, you know, a large utility that would commercially validate that this makes sense in the marketplace. And their view was always, if you could burn natural gas, generate electricity, capture all emissions, you change the world. That's what every utility in the country was gonna want. So that was step two. And then we went through the validation process through testing at our LaPorte site. And then the last piece of the puzzle was understanding what happens to the carbon dioxide on the back end. And that's when Oxy, obviously one of the largest movers of CO2 and sequesters of CO2 in the world, came and invested into the company. And so through those processes, we did further technical validation, commercial validation, and then we just announced another one earlier this year in Baker Hughes investing into the company and designing critical turbine machinery for our process. And that, again, just provides further technical validation because one of the largest original equipment manufacturers in the world believes in the technology and is going to design equipment for us.
Excellent. Thank you for sharing. And Chris, the Silicon Valley model of move fast and break things probably doesn't apply in nuclear, right? Like, we don't embrace this motto. Okay. So tell me more. Tell me more.
Yeah. So you'll see a lot of nuclear companies out there, and they're really studying from a computer-aided perspective. So there's a lot of modeling you can do initially to understand how your reactor will work. But there are a few companies which have really transitioned to doing real R&D. And so at TerraPower, we have a 65,000 square foot lab. And right now there's a big three-story flowing salt tank in there. That's really how we do a lot of the technical validation, is to build small scale demonstrations, use them, understand the fundamentals that are going on, and then scale those up over time. So we're really proud of that, and that's for both of our nuclear technologies, nuclear reactor technologies. And then on the market side, we've worked with Pacificor, the company that's going to build help build our demonstration. We announced a study to build up to five more plants by 2035 with them. So, they've really helped us understand their market, their needs, and have really been great partners with us to kind of help roll out this technology.
That's great. And, entrepreneurship is hard, period. Entrepreneurship is extra hard in an environment where you have to think about the policy environment, the legal elements, the business environment. You're melding all these together in energy. And so what do you think some of the unique challenges are in the energy space for taking entrepreneurial action for a startup to actually be pursuing making an impact in this space? Akash, why don't you start us off?
Ooh, that's a big one. Changing the world requires a lot of collaboration across all sorts of different parts of the government, state, local, federal, right? And that's really important to have open engagement and consistent engagement, and we've done that. You have to make use of every resource you have. A lot of our effort is focused on ensuring that state, local, and federal regulators and politicians understand the potential of the technology to ensure that policy doesn't get ahead of what we can accomplish. So it's making sure that there's a level playing field for all technologies, because it's not going to be any one of us that wins in the energy transition. Everyone needs to have a place for us to get to net zero.
That's fantastic. Thanks for sharing that. Chris?
Well, nuclear takes a long time, right? So, and I think there's a bunch of MBA students, which means there's a lot of understanding of kind of the cost that implies, right? So nuclear development simply takes too long in the U.S. today, whether that be from getting approvals for new designs or testing and actually even building them. So those are a lot of the challenge we've looked at. The government has helped, the Inflation Reduction Act, a lot of the license modernization that happened a few years ago at the NRC. They've really committed to reviewing those applications in a timely manner that really allow for the commercial success of new companies. So working, as Akash said, with the government in order to do that, highly regulated industries like the energy industry, you need that engagement in order to be successful.
Thank you. Annie?
Yeah, I echo what you guys said on terms of thinking very long term. So you guys might be exposed to other kinds of startup type ideas at the business school. In energy in particular, you have to think at the decade long scale. This is both you as a company, as well as in the policy environment and in the customer environment, which is something that I actually enjoy really focused on, is if you have the right investors who really see that long-term opportunity, there's massive upside. So to break those down around like customer policy and tech, on customers, you know, we work with utilities that think long-term as they think towards these 2030, 2035 goals of what does their electricity grid look like in the future. They see that need, that technology gap of what actually is that firm zero carbon resource. And those are the people who we work with today on really delivering and prototyping our first project. So these are long-term customers who think long-term and are willing to take some technology risk on testing out what that technology actually looks like. On the policy side, it's creating that nurturing environment to incentivize customers to make those types of investments, whether it's, you know, pilot scale manufacturing, things like the IRA to really reduce those costs. And so that's very helpful as well in the policy environment. And then on the third piece, you have to time the technology growth to really meet that market need. One thing that I think is special about Form is we started in 2017, where in a future, you know, zero carbon grid seemed very, very far off as a long-term market opportunity. But that market has really changed in the last 5 years. So I think if you see where that market is trending in the long term, take those bets today, because it takes a very long time to commercialize new tech.
And that was a perfect segue into our question around the trends in fundraising for climate and energy-focused startups right now. We are coming out of what has been a very, very frothy private investment marketplace. We are seeing the cooling of that, but there's still a tremendous amount of excitement in the investor community around energy-related startups. And so as you've moved through what seems like very turbulent times in the fundraising environment, what has been your experience for each of your firms to date? And what trends are you seeing? And Chris, I know you've had a very successful recent raise, so you want to share more?
Yeah, so TerraPower recently, within the last few weeks, announced the close of its latest raise. We raised $830 million this time. We knocked on a lot of doors to do that, though. I will tell you that, you know, especially maybe it's nuclear, maybe you will have different success with other technologies, but you've got to knock on a lot of doors, talk to a lot of investors these days. You are right, it is starting to cool somewhat, but I think good ideas are still able to attract good capital in this market.
And Akash?
Yeah, I'd say the same. I can't count how many doors we've knocked on in the 3 years I've been with NetPower. But we've gone through four outside funding rounds. The last one closed earlier this year. The market may have cooled, but again, like you said, the opportunity set is so massive. You're talking about a $1 trillion TAM. Good technology, good business models will get funded. It's just perseverance and going through the process.
That's great. Any?
Yeah, I like what you guys said. There's good funding for good ideas. I will say with the passage of the IRA, that changed things somewhat. That really provided a catalyst and a lot of momentum and investor interest on what this long-term opportunity really looks like and the fact that that's a market need today. So our investors really see that we can scale that to that gigawatt scale to really meet that market need, which is super exciting. I'll also comment on kind of how that's changed in the last, you know, 5 or 10 years. I mean, we can talk about this being kind of a tough environment today, but if you compare the funding available for, you know, technologies like ours 5 years ago versus today, it's a totally different world. I think the market's changed. We're moving faster. This is a really exciting time to come in and join this space.
Fantastic. I'm excited now, so that's terrific. I'm going to ask one more question before I open the floor to all of you to ask questions, so please go ahead and get those in the system. As we think about trade-offs, every time when you have a startup, there's always trade-offs you're having to make. You have a noble objective, but you have to make some tough choices because there are sometimes negative externalities associated with the positive outcomes as well. And so I want to hear more about how each of your firms has thought about balancing the new energy technologies with potentially negative environmental impacts that could be occurring as well as a byproduct. And so, can you, Akash, why don't you tell me more about how you all have thought about this challenge for your own business?
Yeah. We are big believers that fossil fuels are not the problem. It's the carbon that is the problem. And if you look around you, everything you touch from the moment you wake up till the moment you go to bed and you put your head on your pillow has a carbon footprint, right? The average tomato has how many tablespoons of oil in it? Good book to read is How the World Really Works by Vaclav Smil. You know, for NetPower, it's the practical approach to the energy transition. oil and gas will continue to play a role. It's how you dispose of the carbon that needs to be done in a safe manner. And so, you know, that is our focus, and we truly believe in the practical approach. And that means you have to make sure that you're dealing with the carbon responsibly on the back end. And that's why having someone like Occidental in our capital structure is really important, because they have tons of experience moving and sequestering CO2. And that's something that we are continuing to build an expertise in, is going to be very important for us going forward. And philosophically, those are things that really matter, right?
Annie, I mean, you're in the battery space. Mm-hmm. So how have you all thought about the positive impact you're seeking to have with potentially any negative environmental downsides?
Yeah, I'll start with our mission, which is energy storage for a better world, right? And a lot of that is, what does this better world look like? How do we get to a zero carbon electricity grid? So that is the focus, and the problem that we expect to solve with our technology is being able to replace the functionality of gas plants. So the emissions reduction opportunity is massive at the gigaton scale. But we are also very thoughtful on the environmental impact of our technology as well. One is just on, what does the supply chain and manufacturing look like for a technology like ours? For example, even on manufacturing the iron, the way that that's made today is actually pretty carbon intensive. But there are a lot of our strategic investors are investing in new ways to make that carbon free. So for example, the type of iron that we use as a direct reduced iron, that's available in the steel supply chain today. But there are new ways that you can make that using hydrogen or even green hydrogen made from renewables. And that can really reduce the environmental impact of that particular step. So we're already making steps today to figure out what that supply chain looks like, even in the next 5 to 10 years. Another piece is around kind of the recyclability of our battery. This is something I spend a lot of time on. The fundamental components of our system, iron, air, and water, all of this is really fundamentally recyclable. You can use the end components of our system at end of life for other high value offtakes. So this is something we're thoughtful about today, and we expect to continue to build over the next 10 years.
Terrific. I mean, nuclear has its own history, legacy.
You want me to talk about waste?
I do.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah, no. Look, everybody wants to talk about waste, and we should talk about waste. I think we have a great story that we don't talk enough about waste in nuclear, and that's because we store all our waste. If the coal plants and the gas plants stored their waste, we wouldn't be here today, right? So we store our waste. If you laid it all out next to each other, it would, here in the US, it'd be about the size of a football field, right? So all the power, more than half the power we generate here in the US, more than half the carbon-free power we generate here in the US is from nuclear. And we do that today very safely and very efficiently, and we store all the waste that we create. So we're trying, now new technologies, the types of technologies that Natrium will eventually be, will produce 2/3 less of that waste. We still need to figure out how we store some of that, that 1/3 that's left, but we are trying to reduce the amount of volume and look at ways to even reduce the historic volume that already exists.
Terrific. And I want to, we have a question from the audience, and it's for you, Chris. And I think this is, we had it about three different ways this question was asked, which is, as you've moved into communities or are thinking about the growth of nuclear power, what cultural pushback have you received? How are communities thinking about and responding to the idea of a nuclear reactor power plant being in their communities?
Yeah.
How are you changing hearts and minds?
Well, you know, what we're doing and what we've really focused on is replacing coal power plants with nuclear power plants, right? So we're siting our power plant at a retiring coal plant in Kemmerer, Wyoming. There's 400 plus jobs between the coal plant and the mine that's next door that are going away in that community. And 200 to 250 of those could be at our site, right? So jobs are a really important part of the future of energy. You know, there are a lot of people, including myself, right, who've operated power plants who are looking for, that next job, those jobs out there. And so we think that those are great ways to engage with the community to talk about. We've received a lot of support in Wyoming. It's a wind state, it's an energy state, right? So coal, wind, they understand the energy markets, and they've really embraced nuclear from a lot of support from the governor and senators from Wyoming. I think when you get to the local communities, the people who are going to be most directly impacted, I think we find a lot more positive reception to nuclear. I grew up near a nuclear power plant, had family that worked at nuclear power plants. I think it's much different than, you know, over there, there's something that I have an opinion about. So we really find a lot of support in the local communities, actually.
That's terrific. Thanks for sharing that. So I have a question for the broader audience today, which is, I love the framing of this question. What can individuals, what recommendations do you have for individuals? What can they actively do to support innovation and the energy transition without simply sitting back and waiting for corporations and governments to step up and solve this problem, as it were? What would you recommend for this audience of passionate people here today that they could do at an individual level?
Should I start?
Sure. Everybody turned to look to you, Akash. No, I think they just wanted time to think.
I think this is the right start, right? Education is the most important thing. Like, learn more than just the buzzwords. Let's get away from colors of carbon impact, and let's get to numbers, you know, grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour equivalent, right? Like, there just needs to be much more in-depth questions and discovery to really understand the puts and takes of all of our technologies, quite frankly. And so, I don't know, to me, it's educating yourself, and that allows you to educate others, and that allows you to have your voice heard, you know, more broadly. And then as far as, you know, how to get involved, it's entrepreneurship. Like, I had a different route getting to where I am. I kind of did the quote-unquote risk-averse, and went to work on Wall Street, which I don't know if is really risk-averse, but in any event, you know, a different path. But, you know, for someone that wants to go straight into entrepreneurship, in particular in energy, it's being proactive and just really showing your interest and just really sticking to it. It's not like a structured process of recruiting as is with, you know, other industries, and so you really have to, you know, be proactive and really learn and show that you're willing to learn more.
Annie?
Yeah, I'll just say blatantly, the reason I'm here is to recruit. Yeah. you know, the way to fix the problem is join the army of people that are working on solving this problem. And I think that there is no shortage of job opportunities in this space. And I'll echo what I said earlier, it's just very different than it was 5 years ago. If you look on any of these job boards, you know, you can look at the Form Energy careers page, you have to like scroll, you know, we're hiring like hundreds of people over the next year. There's a lot of opportunities. So I encourage you guys, you know, whether it's through internships, research, or just joining a company, that's how you're gonna learn the most, is by just going out and doing the work, because the industry is changing so quickly that it's not really the time to sit back and kind of do the reading, but just join in on the ground and actually just build that transition. So yeah, especially for any engineers in the audience, we're hiring like crazy, including for co-ops and internships. So get started now.
That's awesome. Chris?
I think that's a great answer. You know, when I started at TerraPower, we were 100 people. We're now 400 people. We'll be 600 people pretty soon in a couple of years. And you know, we've hired right here from Duke. And so, yeah, I would say get involved. That's right. If you wanted to pick a career, it might be something along engineering. But there's lots of jobs outside of engineering as well. I don't necessarily have an engineering degree, but, you know, there's a lot of opportunity. And the thing about energy is it changes a lot over time, right? When I got involved, didn't seem like that long ago, everybody was talking about, well, coal to gas, that's the bridge, right? And so everybody was going to build coal or gas plants to replace coal, and that certainly has had some impact, but it's continued to evolve, and you've seen other technologies now, as demonstrated on this panel, that have continued to evolve. And so there's always new opportunities within the energy industry to change.
And I love how you talk about that, Chris, and thinking about how do you develop yourself as a problem solver versus, and because the technology may change over time, but how do you equip yourself with what you're going to need to be an effective problem solver, which is how we think about entrepreneurship education here at Duke, is equipping and building that generation of leaders who are going to be equipped to be able to be the problem solvers as things evolve and change. So thanks for sharing that. All of you mentioned at some point the need to collaborate with government, and I have a question coming in from the audience about digging into that a little bit more and talking about how important it is, how early you should engage, what do those partnerships and collaborations look like? So can you give us a little more flavor and dig in a little bit to the comment that was made or a couple comments that were made about how important that collaboration with the public sector is?
Yeah, so for TerraPower, one, we have a partnership with the DOE to build that demonstration plant. So we've gotten $2 billion award from the DOE, which we matched with $2 billion of private funding to both develop the technology, the supply chain infrastructure, and build the first power plant. So that was certainly part of the partnership, but we also work closely with the NRC, part of the federal government. And that's really key to like the timeline and understanding when your plant's actually going to get built. So we work with both them at the NRC and the DOE to kind of develop our projects, but also things like the IRA, right? And at the federal level, working with congressmen and senators to get those types of things done as well.
Super interesting.
Yeah, I'll echo that it comes at all sectors of government, certainly at the federal level for large federal policies, but also at kind of the state and even at the local permitting level. These also matter a lot for new projects. So at the state level, this could involve, you know, engaging with the Energy Regulatory Commission and helping them really understand how your technology helps solve that state's problems and making sure that they're kind of thinking about the right technologies and ways to do that cost effectively and safely. And then even at the permitting level, as you get towards these first projects, making sure you're doing that kind of local engagement required to get the local communities on board and excited about your project as well. So it really comes at all stages in terms of when to start. Right from the beginning, I would say. I think FORM was started in 2017. We were hiring and working at the policy level pretty within the first couple of years after that. And that's just standard to our approach is you can't just, you have to have the trifecta of, you know, customer policy and technology all at the same time.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, start early. We took a little different approach in that we really didn't get any government funding to this point. We know that there's access to DOE programs, particularly on the loans and grants for commercialization of new technologies. And we have, you know, gone through the process, filed part one, been invited to file part two for the LPO, and then also been invited to file for grants. But we haven't needed it yet. We've gotten funded privately until now to build our demonstration site to technically validate the company in the process. But that didn't stop us from engaging with both sides of the aisle very early. We often have tours for both sides of the aisle at our site. We've done events with, you know, the major energy politicians that you could probably name off the top of your head. So we're actively engaged at that level, but also totally agree the local level is just as important. You need to make sure that local government is supportive of what you're doing, particularly as it relates to permitting and things like that. You know, for Net Power, we're a minor source permit, not a major source permit, so that's not that big of an issue. But certainly, you want to make sure you have engagement both across local, state, and federal level. Excellent. And I couldn't agree more. The IRA has been incredibly impactful for Net Power, in particular with the 45Q enhancements. But I know it's been impactful for all of us.
Can you dig in more to that? That was actually my follow-on question. How is the Inflation Reduction Act impacted your business, and how do you think it's impacting, you know, the opportunities for startups in this space more generally?
Should I?
Go ahead.
So for Net Power, we were effectively cost competitive with an emitting combined cycle gas turbine plant with the existing 45Q legislation, with the enhancements to 45Q, which increased the per ton dollar value and gave a direct pay for the first 5 years. We are now below the cost of a CCGT. So if you think about it, you could build a Net Power plant, capture 100% of the emissions, close to 100% of the emissions, and deploy electricity for cheaper than you could 100% emitting combined cycle gas turbine plant. It is a game changer for Net Power in the U.S.
Chris?
Yeah, so there was a tax credit for nuclear. It's like $18 for about 8 years. We've gone to, you know, something north of $30 for 10 years under the inflation. These are production tax credits for nuclear, and production tax credits are where nuclear works because we have a 94% capacity factor, so we're always generating. That's roughly translates, so the difference between that, the Inflation Reduction Act itself, lowered our LCOE more than $10, like effectively. So it's had a big impact for those initial plants that we'll be rolling out. I think it's a great policy for really getting the industry started.
Yeah, I echo that the IRA is really influential in allowing us to scale to what really needs to happen to get the grid to be carbon free. Just for context, lithium ion was invented in a lab in the 1980s, and it took decades to get to gigawatt scale. For us to deliver on the impact that we need and meet the grid requirements, we have to get to that scale in less than a decade. And so the IRA allows us to do that. It allows us to invest in the manufacturing capacity, in all the human resource requirements, the hiring. You know, it allows us to really invest in that and to really meet what the grid needs in terms of resilience and zero carbon.
So let me ask one more audience question. Besides the technology that your own company is leveraging, what interesting energy innovations do you think are most exciting or most promising?
Well, I think one thing kind of building from the Inflation Reduction Act, there's $3 a kilogram hydrogen credit. I think others will talk about hydrogen, so I won't go too much there, but I do think hydrogen is going to be really important as a fuel, especially within the industrial side of the equation. And I think there will be opportunities for technologies such as nuclear to be part of that cycle.
Excellent. Annie?
Yeah, I echo that there's a lot of opportunity for hydrogen. And as I mentioned earlier, this is actually really important for the life cycle emissions of our own battery technology. We need to source green hydrogen at the industrial scale to make the iron anodes that we need. So that's super critical and allows us to do that cost effectively. So that's super exciting. I'm trying not to, like, my first answer is always like, form is the coolest. but I do think that maybe this is just broad excitement for the industry and technology innovation in general, including with battery technology. If you just look at any cost curve, right, and just look at the cost reductions of wind, solar, batteries over the last 10 years, and it looks like that, the IRA is just going to continue that curve down. So really any company that you join, it's going to be very fun to really optimize what that cost reduction really looks like to get to what to get a very cost-effective grid.
Yeah, I think everything that all of us are working on is really exciting, and hydrogen also. Given where Net Power sits, I think the carbon economy, just what happens to all the CO2 that gets put off industrial plants that are going to capture their emissions, and what happens when you have a cheap form of capture and you can utilize that CO2 for carbon nano or graphite, whatever it is, like there's an entire economy of CO2 that will form off the back of this, which I think is really exciting.
That's great. So we have a lot of young professionals in the audience today. So our final question for you is really around what recommendations you have for any of the young professionals who may be thinking post-graduation, I want to go work at a climate or energy-focused startup. What advice would you give them about this journey? Akash.
Call me. look, all like it's clear, obviously, like there's a lot of hiring going on across, all of our companies, and getting talent is obviously critical to that, and getting people that want to have an impact. I think that's the most important thing: people that care, people that want to have an impact.
That's great, Annie.
Yeah, check out our careers page, or just feel to direct message me. I'll also say, particularly because I also went to business school, something I found was interesting is if you can do term time research projects or internships, it's a great way to offer free help to companies, and it's a way to get you acquainted with the industry. Even like an internship in an energy company is just going to way differentiate you versus a lot of other applicants. So go out and get it.
Great advice.
Yeah. So after business school, I worked at a utility for about 5 years. I would say understanding the customer is always an important thing. So, think about, as was said in the last panel, you don't have to work at the utility forever, but understanding that environment and the regulations that they have to deal with is really important. So,
thank you. So as I listened to our panel today, I wanted to summarize a few takeaway points that I'm walking away with. Again, focus on the problem first. I love that point from Annie, and really thinking about that early engagement with your potential customer to understand what it's going to take to motivate change. Collaboration. Collaboration is required, and that includes with the government and the public sector. Do it early, do it often, is what I heard. And then there's a place for all of us to succeed if we're going to actually reach net zero, and that we have to think about this innovation on a decade-long scale, or decades, perhaps, long scale with an S there. But really, the time is now to get started. The opportunities have never been greater, and the needs have never been more significant. And I'm hearing from all of you that there's an opportunity for every person in this room to focus their energy and their passion on helping us solve these critical problems that we face. So please join me in thanking our panelists today. So grateful for your time.